other soccer trophies.
Nice.
And then maybe soccer trophies and basketball trophies.
Nice.
So before we get started, I just want to say thank you for coming on my podcast today. I've been following you for a long time. You do a great job, and I just want to say congrats to your new chapter with the Cubs. So
thank you. Thanks. I'm excited. I appreciate that.
Yeah. So how are you and your family doing, by the way, during this tough situation?
You know, we're good. We're hanging in there. I think like everybody else, just try to make the best of it. I don't really know what that is, but you wake up every day and entertain yourself, and guess it's one day closer to being over.
Yeah, so if you don't mind, can you take me back on your journey? Where, when did you get interested in the sports business, and when did you get interested in, especially the in baseball, being a writer in baseball? When did you get interested in that?
Yeah, so I guess baseball, really my whole life. I grew up around this sport, so I've always had interest in Major League Baseball. But I really became interested in sports broadcasting when I was in high school and would watch college football. And that was in the time when Erin Andrews was on College Game Day, and there were so many females on the sidelines, and then even females on the sidelines of the NFL games. And I just remember those were the type of jobs that I thought were so awesome. And that was around high school time, because before that I wanted to be in the CIA, which is just hilarious, which is complete opposite of being on TV. But yeah, in high school, and then in college, I went to Arkansas, which is in the SEC, a huge football conference. Loved watching the game and followed college football religiously and kind of always wanted to do that. And then because of my baseball background, kind of got thrown into, doing baseball, which is something that I'm grateful for and that I've loved doing. And it was always a sport that I enjoyed. But I honestly never really had the vision of or thought that I would be a reporter for a Major League Baseball team. I kind of always just thought I would do college football and stick with that. But it's been a lot of fun to do baseball and then, of course, to do college football as well.
Interesting. So I saw before we get to like your new situation, how is it working with I think your last job was with the Colorado Rockies, right, if I'm not mistaken?
Yes.
Yeah. So how was that experience like working with the Rockies?
It was awesome. It was so much fun. The first year I was there, the team was really good. They were vying for a National League West title, the first one in franchise history. They ended up losing to the Dodgers in a game 163. But it was so much fun the whole season because there was meaningful games deep late into the year. And when you cover a 162 game season, that's what you hope for, is that down the stretch, you're still playing meaningful baseball. And so that was just such a fun year. And I'm from Denver, and just to be a part of that was so much fun. And then last year was a little different experience. It's such a fun job. You get to travel all around the country, and you go to a ballpark for your job. So it's not the worst thing in the world, but it was challenging last year because the team wasn't as good. And so all of a sudden in August and September, there was really no chance of making the postseason. And so you kind of had to get creative as a reporter, and it challenged me in an entirely different way. I still enjoyed it, but it was definitely challenging. So I just loved my experience with them. I'm so thankful that they gave me an opportunity, and it was so much fun. I'll always look back on those years with such a smile.
So I'm a Yankee fan, and I saw your recent I don't know when, but I saw your interview with Miranda Markovich on Instagram Live, and she's amazing. She's amazing at what she does with the Yankees and everything else. So how is it like connecting with those like fellow coworkers that you like Meredith Marakovich, Lauren Shahadi? How's that like working with them and as a team?
Yeah, I mean, Meredith is awesome. And it's funny because when I first started with the Rockies, I had a few people say, hey, you kind of remind me of Meredith Mrokhavets with the Yankees. And of course I knew who she was, but I started really watching her and I was like, oh, well, that's a compliment because she's so good. And I just think she really leads the charge of all female reporters, well, all reporters in Major League Baseball. She does such a good job covering them extensively. She's being so creative right now, and her time not with Yes day to day, you know, she's doing her own happy hour with Mayor or whatever it's called. And so that just kind of shows how innovative she is. And she was so kind to me the moment I met her last season when we were at Yankee Stadium. So that's been really fun. And then Lauren Shahadi, I actually got to know as an intern when I was interning at MLB Network, and she was so good to me. I remember when we first got there, the executives were like, well, don't talk to the talent. And so I, of course, was definitely paranoid little intern. I was like, well, I'm not going to talk to the talent. Well, and I didn't, but we would ride on the same bus together to get on the train to go back into the city because the network is in Secaucus. And so we would be on the same little bus together every single day. And so she finally started talking to me and just said, hey, I'm Lauren. And took that initiative, which was so nice of her, and she didn't need to do that. And then kind of like every day she would ask me questions, and we just kind of formed a relationship that way, riding back on the train together to the city every single day. So she was amazing, and it's been fun to follow her career as she continually gets opportunities at different networks and, of course, is doing extremely well at MLB and has a phenomenal personal life and family. And so she's really I adore her. I think it's the world of her. But it's so fun to hear other women's stories all across the game. And I think I remember when I first got the job, Alana Rizzo was like, well, it's a big sorority between all of us. And I've really felt that everywhere you go, you know, we reach out to each other and we help each other too. I mean, there's been so many times I've been on the road and it's game 120 and you're looking for content, and you can reach out to the other reporter and say, hey, do you have anything on your guys? And I've gotten so many good stories from other reporters who've helped me get to know their team, because sometimes it is nice to hear from other teams when, you know, even though you're covering the Rockies, you still talk about the other team that you're facing. So it's been so much fun to hear from all of them.
So now to your new journey, the Cubs. So how did you get that new opportunity? Was it like hard to leave the Rockies, or you wanted to go to a different direction?
Yeah, I had no plans of leaving the Rockies. I loved that job, and I felt like I had an opportunity with ESPN to kind of do Rockies in ESPN. And so I was good. This is my home. You know, I thought everything was great. And then I had somebody reach out to me and say, hey, you really should consider this job. And so I talked with, I didn't even know they were launching their own network. Are you there? Can you hear me? You broke up a little.
Can you see me? Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
The Wi-Fi has been crazy here lately, so I don't know.
Oh, shoot. Well, I can see you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, good. So basically, yeah, I had no real plans on leaving the Rockies, and then I got a call from the Cubs and kind of talked with a lot of people about it, thought it was the right opportunity, and I'm super excited, was really excited at spring training. It was so much fun. And then, of course, the season gets delayed, so it's pushed back a little bit. But I really am excited for what Marquis can be for Chicago and for Cub fans. And then, of course, with our crew, you know, we're all new. So that kind of provides a unique opportunity, because a lot of times you come into a place and there's kind of already been things that have been going on and they've already been doing things a certain way. But with us, we're all getting the chance to create this together. And so that was really exciting for me as well, the opportunity to create something. And the Cubs have never had a full-time reporter. You know, they've had reporters, but not somebody who travels and does all of the games. And so for me, it's kind of an opportunity to be something that they've never had, which is really fun, and to do it with a franchise like the Cubs. So much history is really, really exciting.
So before we get to the Cubs, I heard a report today on somewhere on Twitter or Facebook where they said the season might return July 4th. Do you expect that to happen July 4th? I heard somewhere.
You know, I've heard a lot of things. I have no idea. I've kind of, you know, we can just sit here and debate and discuss all the possible things until there's something actually from Major League Baseball. I don't know. I think July is probably a realistic start date when you consider where Major League Baseball is at in terms of paying their employees. They said through the end of May. And so you kind of feel like there needs to be a decision by then. And if you consider you have to have probably a week for teams to get to their spring training site before the season starts, and then a 3-week long spring training that puts you early July. So to me, it makes sense. But again, we don't really know. And this virus is evolving every single moment. So we'll kind of see. But I think a early July start date definitely is feasible.
So getting to the Cubs, what are your thoughts on this team? But from afar, and now you're with them. So what do you think of this Cubs team?
Gosh, they're such an exciting group. I mean, you just look at the talent there, all homegrown players, and, you know, the Schwarbers, the Baezes, the Bryants, and even the Rizzo. I know he wasn't technically homegrown, but his kind of spent the majority of his major league career with the Cubs, and the history that they were able to diminish and set after that 108 years without a World Series. It's such an exciting group, and they mean so much to the city of Chicago. And they've all just, I mean, I've spent a limited amount of time around all of them, but, you know, they've been so welcoming to me, which I'm thankful for. I noticed day one from stepping into that clubhouse how much fun they all have, and they genuinely seem to love being with the Cubs and being with this team, which is huge, I think, especially in a baseball season where it's a grind and there's days when you don't want to play and your body isn't in it. But when you have guys around you who are lifting you up, that's so important. And I definitely feel like this group has it. And I'm excited to see kind of what they do this season and then coming seasons as well.
Do you see them trading like Chris Bryant eventually, because to save up money or whatever, like make the team better? Because I heard rumors where the Colorado and the Cubs were discussing a trade where you swap Nolan Arenado for Chris Bryant. I don't know if that's possible.
That was the rumors. That did not happen. I don't think there was going to be a straight up one for one trade. I think, you know, different sides wanted different things than more than just that. Of course, you've heard the rumors. Chris heard them. He addressed them. And we'll kind of see what happens. But I don't know. I mean, we'll see. He's talked about how he loves being a Chicago Cub. But ultimately, it is a business, and there's a lot of things that need to happen. And I think it's interesting, too, the where we are in baseball right now, because this season was kind of going to be what set the tone for whether or not Theo was going to trade away the core group of guys, because he had said, if they don't perform, then I'm going to break them up. And they kind of, you know, without him actually saying it, they kind of had till the All-Star break to set their own destiny. If they, you know, played well, then he was probably going to keep them together at least for the rest of the season. And if not, he was probably going to trade away some key pieces. But obviously, the trade deadline is going to look differently this year. So I don't have the answer for that. I think there's a possibility, but I also think there's a possibility that he stays. I mean, he hasn't turned down any contracts that we know of, and he denied that in his presser, saying, I have not turned anything down. So I'm interested to see what happens with that. But and I think everything's on the table, as it always is. So we'll see.
Your new chapter with the Cubs. So
thank you. Thanks. I'm excited. I appreciate that.
Yeah. So how are you and your family doing, by the way, during this tough situation?
You know, we're good. We're hanging in there. I think like everybody else, just try to make the best of it. And I don't really know what that is, but you wake up every day and entertain yourself and guess it's one day closer to being over.
Yeah, so if you don't mind, can you take me back on your journey? Where, when did you get interested in the sports business, and when did you get interested in, especially the in baseball, being a writer in baseball? When did you get interested in that?
Yeah, so I guess baseball, really my whole life. I grew up around the sport, so I've always had interest in Major League Baseball. But I really became interested in sports broadcasting when I was in high school and would watch college football. And that was in the time when Erin Andrews was on College Game Day, and there were so many females on the sidelines, and then even females on the sidelines of the NFL games. And I just remember those were the type of jobs that I thought were so awesome. And that was around high school time, because before that I wanted to be in the CIA, which is just hilarious, which is complete opposite of being on TV. But so yeah, in high school, and then in college, I went to Arkansas, which is in the SEC, a huge football conference. Loved watching the game and followed college football religiously and kind of always wanted to do that. And then because of my baseball background, kind of got thrown into, you know, doing baseball, which is something that I'm grateful for and that I've loved doing. And it was always a sport that I enjoyed. But I honestly never really had the vision of or thought that I would be a reporter for a Major League Baseball team. I kind of always just thought I would do college football and stick with that. But it's been a lot of fun to do baseball and then, of course, to do college football as well.
Interesting. So I saw before we get to like your new situation, how is it working with I think your last job was with the Colorado Rockies, right, if I'm not mistaken?
Yes.
Yeah. So how was that experience like working with the Rockies?
It was awesome. It was so much fun. The first year I was there, the team was really good. They were vying for a National League West title, the first one in franchise history. They ended up losing to the Dodgers in a game 163. But it was so much fun the whole season because there was meaningful games deep late into the year. And when you cover a 162 game season, that's what you hope for, is that down the stretch, you're still playing meaningful baseball. And so that was just such a fun year, and I'm from Denver, and just to be a part of that was so much fun. And then last year was a little different experience. It's such a fun job. You get to travel all around the country, and you go to a ballpark for your job. So it's not the worst thing in the world, but it was challenging last year because the team wasn't as good. And so all of a sudden in August and September, there was really no chance of making the postseason. And so you kind of had to get creative as a reporter. And it challenged me in an entirely different way. I still enjoyed it, but it was definitely challenging. So I just loved my experience with them. I'm so thankful that they gave me an opportunity. And it was so much fun. I'll always look back on those years with such a smile.
So I'm a Yankee fan, and I saw your recent, I don't know when, but I saw your interview with Miranda Markovich on Instagram Live, and she's amazing. She's amazing at what she does with the Yankees and everything else. So how is it like connecting with those like fellow coworkers that you, like Miranda Markovich, Lauren Shahadi? How is that like working with them and as a team?
Yeah, I mean, Meredith is awesome. And it's funny because when I first started with the Rockies, I had a few people say, hey, you kind of remind me of Meredith Markovich with the Yankees. And of course I knew who she was, but I started really watching her and I was like, oh, well, that's a compliment because she's so good. And I just think she really leads the charge of all female reporters, well, all reporters in Major League Baseball. She does such a good job covering them extensively. She's being so creative right now, and her time not with Yes day to day, you know, she's doing her own happy hour with Mayor or whatever it's called. And so that just kind of shows how innovative she is. And she was so kind to me the moment I met her last season when we were at Yankee Stadium. So that's been really fun. And then Lauren Shahadi, I actually got to know as an intern when I was interning at MLB Network, and she was so good to me. I remember when we first got there, the executives were like, well, don't talk to the talent. And so I, of course, was definitely paranoid little intern, and I was like, well, I'm not gonna talk to the talent. Well, and I didn't, but we would ride on the same bus together to get on the train to go back into the city, because the network is in Secaucus. And so we would be on the same little bus together every single day. And so she finally started talking to me and just said, hey, I'm Lauren, and took that initiative, which was so nice of her, and she didn't need to do that. And then kind of like every day she would ask me questions, and we just kind of formed a relationship that way, riding back on the train together to the city every single day. So she was amazing, and it's been fun to follow her career as she continually gets opportunities at different networks, and of course is doing extremely well at MLB, and has a phenomenal personal life and family. And so she's really, I adore her. I think it's the world of her. But it's so fun to hear other women's stories all across the game. And I think I remember when I first got the job, Alana Rizzo was like, well, it's a big sorority between all of us. And I've really felt that everywhere you go, you know, we reach out to each other and we help each other too. I mean, there's been so many times I've been on the road and it's game 120 and you're looking for content, and you can reach out to the other reporter and say, hey, do you have anything on your guys? And I've gotten so many good stories from other reporters who've helped me get to know their team, because sometimes it is nice to hear from other teams when, you know, even though you're covering the Rockies, you still talk about the other team that you're facing. So it's been so much fun to hear from all of them.
So now to your new journey, the Cubs. How did you get that new opportunity? Was it like hard to leave the Rockies, or you wanted to go to a different direction?
Yeah, I had no plans of leaving the Rockies. I loved that job, and I felt like I had an opportunity with ESPN to kind of do Rockies and ESPN. And so I was good. This is my home. You know, I thought everything was great. And then I had somebody reach out to me and say, hey, you really should consider this job. And so I talked with, I didn't even know they were launching their own network. Are you there? Can you hear me? You broke up a little.
Can you see me? Can you hear me now?
Yeah. Can you hear me?
The Wi-Fi has been crazy here lately, so I don't know.
Oh, shoot. Well, I can see you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, good. So basically, yeah, I had no real plans on leaving the Rockies, and then I got a call from the Cubs and kind of talked with a lot of people about it, thought it was the right opportunity, and I'm super excited, was really excited at spring training. It was so much fun. And then of course the season gets delayed, so it's pushed back a little bit, but I really am excited for what Marquee's going to be for Chicago and for Cub fans. And then of course with our crew, you know, we're all new. So that kind of provides a unique opportunity, because a lot of times you come into a place and there's kind of already been things that have been going on and they've already been doing things a certain way. But with us, we're all getting the chance to create this together. And so that was really exciting for me as well, the opportunity to create something. And the Cubs have never had a full-time reporter. You know, they've had reporters, but not somebody who travels and does all of the games. And so for me, it's kind of an opportunity to be something that they've never had, which is really fun, and to do it with a franchise like the Cubs. So much history is really, really exciting.
So before we get to the Cubs, I heard a report today on somewhere on Twitter or Facebook where they said the season might return July 4th. Do you expect that to happen July 4th? I heard somewhere.
You know, I've heard a lot of things. I have no idea. I've kind of, you know, we can just sit here and debate and discuss all the possible things until there's something actually from Major League Baseball. I don't know. I think July is probably a realistic start date when you consider where Major League Baseball is at in terms of paying their employees. They said through the end of May. And so you kind of feel like there needs to be a decision by then. And if you consider you have to have probably a week for teams to get to their spring training site before the season starts, and then a 3-week long spring training, that puts you early July. So to me, it makes sense. But again, we don't really know. And this virus is evolving every single moment. So we'll kind of see. But I think a early July start date definitely is feasible.
So getting to the Cubs, what are your thoughts on this team? But from afar, and now you're with them. So what do you think of this Cubs team?
Gosh, they're such an exciting group. I mean, you just look at the talent there, all homegrown players, and you know, the Schwarbers, the Baezes, the Bryants, and even the Rizzo. I know he wasn't technically homegrown, but his kind of spent the majority of his major league career with the Cubs, and the history that they were able to diminish and set after that 108 years without a World Series. It's such an exciting group, and they mean so much to the city of Chicago. And they've all just, I mean, I've spent a limited amount of time around all of them, but, you know, they've been so welcoming to me, which I'm thankful for. And I noticed day one from stepping into that clubhouse, how much fun they all have, and they genuinely seem to love being with the Cubs and being with this team, which is huge, I think, especially in a baseball season where it's a grind and there's days when you don't want to play and your body isn't in it. But when you have guys around you who are lifting you up, that's so important. And I definitely feel like this group has it. And I'm excited to see kind of what they do this season and then coming seasons as well.
Do you see them trading like Chris Bryant eventually, because to save up money or whatever, like make the team better? Because I heard rumors where the Colorado and the Cubs were discussing a trade where you swapped Nolan Arenado for Chris Bryant. I don't know if that's possible.
That was the rumors. That did not happen. I don't think there was going to be a straight up one for one trade. I think, you know, different sides wanted different things than more than just that. Of course, you've heard the rumors. Chris heard them. He addressed them. And we'll kind of see what happens. But I don't know. I mean, we'll see. He's talked about how he loves being a Chicago Cub, but ultimately it is a business and there's a lot of things that need to happen. And I think it's interesting too, where we are in baseball right now, because this season was kind of going to be what set the tone for whether or not Theo was going to trade away the core group of guys, because he had said, if they don't perform, then I'm going to break them up. And they kind of, you know, without him actually saying it, they kind of had till the All-Star break to set their own destiny. If they, you know, played well, then he was probably going to keep them together at least for the rest of the season. And if not, he was probably going to trade away some key pieces. But obviously the trade deadline is going to look differently this year. So I don't have the answer for that. I think there's a possibility, but I also think there's a possibility that he stays. I mean, he hasn't turned down any contracts that we know of, and he denied that in his presser, saying, I have not turned anything down. So I'm interested to see what happens with that. And I think everything's on the table, as it always is. So we'll see. Thoughts on what?
Thoughts on David Ross as the new manager.
you know, he's been in the, again, I've had limited time with him, but he has been so much fun. He brings such an energy. And I think there's people who just have an ability to bring the best out of people. And he's definitely one of those guys. You can sense the amount of love that the players in the clubhouse have for him. And he has a unique background in the sense he was in that 2016 clubhouse. And so he knows what it takes to win. And what I've heard him say so much, and I think is really going to go a long way, is just installing the little things that make you a winner. You know, it's the little things adding up. And I think in so far in spring, you see him do that as a manager, kind of setting the tone with the guys. So he's been great. I'm really excited to see what he does. There's no doubt some challenges ahead, but I think he's looking forward to those challenges, and I look forward to seeing how he handles all those.
So, I mean, I want to ask you this question. Obviously now the women's are getting opportunities to coach male sports. And obviously we see this offseason with the Giants hiring Elise. I think her name is Elisa or something. Yeah, Elisa, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
And then Rachel from the Yankees hired Rachel. And I had the opportunity to interview Rachel Bulkovich last week, actually, on my podcast. And she was inspiring. And so I just want to get your take on how this has evolved, especially for you and all these women getting opportunities to coach male sports now.
Well, you know, what's cool is I think when women get opportunities, it should be because they deserve it and not because they're just a woman.
Yeah.
And seeing that the women who get these opportunities truly have put in the work and they're the best choice. And that's, to me, what's been so cool is seeing those women work really hard and being equal and getting the opportunity to prove that. And, you know, I think what's cool about sport is it's constantly changing in the way that women are more accepted, because women are proving that they can do just as good, if not a better job than some of the males in that role. And that's why they are deserving of those roles, you know, and I don't think any of them want to say, oh, we deserve this role because we're a woman. We deserve it because we're good. And to me, that's what's been the coolest part about the way we've seen the games change, is these amazing women come in, step into these roles and just do amazing jobs. So like you said, they're inspirations because they, you know, they put in the work and they're really good at what they do. So that's what's been so cool about the way that our game is evolving.
Who was your role model in the sports industry growing up?
Well, you know, like I said, I kind of in high school started thinking about this as a career. Growing up in Colorado, watching the Rockies, it was Carissa Thompson and then Alana Rizzo. So those were kind of the women I saw on TV. And you think, well, I could do that, you know, because it's somebody who looks like me. So I could do something like that. And then in college, I loved Sam Ponder on game day. And I just love what she's about as a person. And so I watched her a ton. And then, I mean, there's so many women who, Tracy Wolfson, who has achieved longevity in this business, which is a challenge in and of itself. You know, this business is already competitive, but then to achieve the longevity that she has, she's really good. I think there's a lot of Sage Steele with ESPN. I admire her work. Laura Rutledge, Maria Taylor, all the ones that we see now who've kind of worked their way up. Just getting a college football package to now being on NBA Countdown and Get Up. So there's so many that I could point to. But I would say those are kind of the ones that I watch on a regular basis. Allie LaForce, she was with SEC on CBS when I was in college and loved watching her. I think she's so good. And cool what her and her husband are doing, with their foundation and just making a difference on and off the court, or the field, if depending upon if you're talking about her husband or her. So, there's so many of them that I kind of look to and, try to, you know, admire and learn from.
So, whenever the season comes back, I say 80 to 100 games in that middle, 80 to 100. What do you see? 80 to 100?
I see as many games as humanly possible. I know that's one thing that both the owners and the players can agree upon, is they want to play as many games as possible. I could see about 100 game regular season and then maybe an expanded postseason if games start in July. Again, we don't know the status of everything, but I do see that as a distinct possibility. And like I said, they're going to try to play as many games as possible. So who knows, maybe they could get creative with double headers and all sorts of things and try to squeeze in as many. But I would say, like I just mentioned, probably 100 games is pretty realistic, and then maybe an expanded postseason.
Do you think their goal is to play without fans for now, or they're waiting to see if everything clears up in the July March to see if they allow fans to come in, or do you think they'll play without fans at first?
Well, I think their goal would be to play with fans, but of course you have to take into account what the CDC is recommending, and of course we have to monitor this virus, and the safety of everybody is at the utmost importance. And so in reality, we've heard so many people say, until there is a vaccination, you will not see full stadiums. And I believe that. I don't think we will see a full stadium this season, probably not till next, and maybe even the middle of next season. I don't really know. But in the meantime, just getting back to each city individually, and then travel would kind of be the first hurdle that you jump over. And then maybe a limited number of fans. But to me, the limited number of fans seems so tricky, because you all come through the same gates, you know, it's hard to make sure everybody holds themselves accountable as fans, as far as the separation and social distancing within the stadium. So I don't know if that's feasible. Again, so many things are on the table, and there's people who might be more creative than myself, but right away, it's, I think, just getting probably to the home cities. And then as far as fans, that's going to come later on down the road.
Yes. So thoughts on, I'm going to talk about a few things here with the Yankees real quick, if you don't mind. Thoughts on Garrett Cole and what he can bring for us in New York this year.
So it's funny. I was an intern in Pittsburgh when he made his major league debut. And of course, being the number one pick in 2013, I think, or 2011 when he was drafted, he made his debut in 2013, whatever year it was. There was so much anticipation for him. And I mean, he's an elite top of the rotation guy who you can count on every 5 days. And I think that's what the Yankees can expect, is somebody to go out there and set the tone every single day to win. He's ridiculous. And what he did in the postseason, I mean, he's a proven winner. And I know a lot of teams wanted his services, but ultimately the Yankees won. And I think a large part of that is because he wanted to be in New York. And so I think that's awesome in its own right. The fact that you have somebody who wants to be there, has been a Yankee fan his entire life, that provides a whole new dynamic that I don't think gets talked about enough, is the personal element of the fandom within players and what that can kind of bring. I mean, we talk a lot about Kyle Freeland in Denver. He's from Colorado. And so it almost means more to him in a sense, because it's his team, it's his city. And I think Garrett Cole is like that. Although he's not from New York, he grew up a huge New York fan. His dad's from the area. So I think that's a really cool perspective that he brings, and a new layer, I should say, in addition to his dominance on the mound.
Yeah, so I'm going to put you on the spot right now here. So,
gosh.
So I've been asking all my friends, they're Yankee fans also, and I've been asking all the guests, I mean, all the specific guests I have on the show with the Yankees, I keep asking, do you think Aaron Judge is worth $100
million? Well, $100 million over how many years?
6, 7, or 8, or even more.
So yeah, eight years, 100 mil, absolutely. I mean, with the way the players are getting paid these days, I mean, you see $30 million a year players at the top of baseball, the kind of the core guys, and he definitely is that in New York. So you know, it's hard to say somebody worth that much money. I don't know if anybody's worth that much money, but with the trend in which players are signing contracts, I think his value in free agency is certainly that high, especially if you talk about 8 years, 100 mil. I mean, how much is that a year? I'm not, it's a little over like 12, something like that. I don't know, whatever math, it's not for me apparently. But you know, that really, the breakdown of that by year isn't a whole lot in comparison to what other guys who put up his type of numbers and who are the franchise players are making.
Interesting. Before I let you go, I got a few rapid fire questions and a couple takes here, but here's the first one. Who will win the championship first, Torres or Baez? Obviously, Baez haven't won yet, and the Cubs year yet. But who will win the championship first, Torres or Baez?
I'm probably gonna go with Torres. I mean, you guys are stacked. I think this year, and now too, that you have the chance to heal the starting rotation after it took some hits, could be really dominant in years to come. So, yeah, I'm going to go with Glaber on that one.
Favorite food?
Pizza.
Favorite hip-hop artist, old school and currently?
Hip-hop?
Yeah.
Gosh. Usher, old school. Currently? You know, she was a country artist, but I think she's more hip hop now, Taylor Swift. I mean, I'm going to be honest. I love her. Love Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Her music's definitely she's amazing. Fun. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I agree. Favorite thing to do outside of your work?
Just be outside. I love to just bike ride, be outside, hang out, be active. Challenging in these times, but yeah.
Favorite sports movie?
The Sandlot.
Favorite non-sports movie?
Oh man. What is my favorite movie? I don't know. That's a good one. You know, I've watched it way too many times. Made in Manhattan. I know that's probably not a good answer, but the amount of times I've watched that growing up was ridiculous. I loved that movie.
Last couple of things here. This question, because I've been asking all my guests that come on the show about the late Kobe Bryant. Mm-hmm. He was one of my role models growing up playing for the Lakers. I've been getting on him and his daughter. So what does he mean to you, and what does mama mentality mean to you?
Yeah, I think what he meant to everybody, he transcended sport. And I think what he was doing for women's athletics was amazing to see through Gigi and through the Mamba Academy. The way that he kind of let go of basketball and said, I'm not going to let that be the best thing that's ever happened to me. And he constantly was striving to, you know, do something else and do something better. I think that just speaks so highly, especially you see athletes so many times they get out and they're like, now what? You know, I'm used